saying happy birthday and happy anniversary to the Peace Corps on this episode of Travel Television. A BBC member organization providing short-term experiences for professionals coming up in this episode of Travel Television. All this and more, so on to our first stop.
Globalware operates in 15 countries, but we have 17 programs, and one of them includes a program working with really needy children. A volunteer with Globalware typically signs up between 2 to 6 months before their desired program date. They're often traveling over a holiday like 4th of July or Thanksgiving or Martin Luther King Day. They arrive with 9 other volunteers, often I would say about half the time people travel with someone else they already know, and the other half they just show up by themselves. They arrive on a Saturday and they work about 35 to 38 hours a week on a project, and it varies by location. Where there are 15 countries where we work, 17 different programs, and in Cambodia we assemble wheelchairs for landmine victims. In Peru we build adobe Lorena stoves. In Ghana, we build schools. In Vietnam, we build homes. So every program is very different, and they want it very tightly organized. They want to have a tangible project at the end of it that they can look at. They want to be able to interact with the community in a meaningful way. They want their leisure time organized. And then there's usually 3 to 4 planned but optional cultural excursions. So in Costa Rica, we'll have a coffee tasting, a waterfall hike. We go and see the bats, any of the local wonders to see. So we really try and have all of it incorporated into the week and the program. And we take a lot of our meals with the local families when we can find a way to do it that's healthy and good for the community. So that's what a typical week is like on our programs. And Concrete Pictures did a 10-part series, 10 one-hour episodes on our program there. We are working with deaf orphans.
We normally bring people down here for 1 week at a time. This time, since we're here for longer, we've decided to tackle 8 different projects, one for each volunteer.
The project Jimbo and I worked on was to close the garbage area. Very crude, tough circumstances.
You are the reason we are building a wall.
There's so much that we need to do here.
The volunteers are just ordinary people that are willing to give up their time and their love and do something special with it.
The pressure to be a group is extraordinary. We all come from all over, and we have different ages, races, backgrounds, job skills, and personal experiences.
I would like to walk away from the trip knowing that I gave these kids a little bit of hope.
At this stage, I don't think they quite realize how difficult it's going to be and how many problems we're going to run into.
It's going to take forever.
This is stupid. It means we have to redo everything.
It cracks me up. Some of the shit that you guys just do there.
For the longest time, there's been a bit of a power struggle.
I came to the conclusion that part of the group lost their focus as to why they were here.
In watching the children open their presents, some of them didn't even know how to open a present. I mean, can you imagine a child never having a present wrapped and given to them?
You grow attached to these kids, and you want so much to protect them in every way. And you can't imagine your life without them.
It's going to be real hard to say goodbye to the volunteers, strangers who have now become my good friends.
I know for certain that many people go home realizing how rich their lives are.
joy. Pure joy.
Volunteering in a rural community with no electricity or running water is the challenge facing the students from the New York Institute School of Health Professions and other volunteers from the New York Institute of Technology chapter of Engineers Without Borders. Both groups traveled to Ghana and provided healthcare and assistance in the development of sustainable projects to improve sanitation and water quality in the region. Teaching local nurses how to provide healthcare and establishing a prenatal care system during their 3-week stay provided the foundation of new bonds and friendships that helped improve quality of life and inspired the volunteers.
Hi, my name is Emily LaBelle. I'm a second year student at NICOM, and I participated in the Center for Global Health's trip to Ghana this summer. After 3 weeks of global health, tropical medicine, and cultural competency coursework, our group of medical students, nursing students, and PA students embarked with 3 physicians on a much anticipated trip that would knowingly change the rest of our lives. After a 15-hour plane ride and a 6-hour bus trip, we arrived in the rural village of Awarabang in Ghana, West Africa, and were introduced to a new reality entirely different from our own. Although we all slept in the same bunk beds, tended to patients in the same clinic, and walked the same roads daily, our trip made different, drastic, and lasting impressions on all who took part.
One of my favorite memories from Ghana, specifically Awarabang, was from our first day when we toured the village. At first, it was just us students walking around with Jesse Road giving the tour. But by the end, there were what seemed to be about 50 children walking with us, laughing with us, and holding our hands. They were so happy and welcoming. It was such an amazing start to an unbelievable experience in Ghana.
I have never seen people with what initially seemed to be so little, with such huge hearts, welcoming spirits, and incredible outlooks on life. Every single child, parent, patient, and village chief was so grateful for our efforts to help their people and voiced their appreciation to us on a daily basis. What they may not have realized is that they enhanced our own appreciation for things often taken for granted, and they have humbled us in an unimaginable way. We will all take our experiences from Awarabang with us as we practice medicine in the future.
The trip to Ghana was an amazing adventure. The memories we made there will stay with us for the rest of our lives, and hopefully we make us better and more competent doctors.
Ghana, it was home. The rural village was humid, had many insects, and there was no running water or electricity, but it was our home nonetheless. It was humble, natural, beautiful, and richly cultured. We witnessed both life and death in between diagnosing endless cases of malaria. This once-in-a-lifetime experience gave us new respect for medicine and what we are pursuing, all while enjoying the company of the Ghanaian people under the clear starlit sky.
Ghana to me was a humbling experience that opened my eyes to what seemed like another world, but was just another way of life.
To me, the best part was meeting the people of Awarabang. They were all so kind and warm and welcoming that it made us all feel really comfortable, and it made it the perfect environment in which to learn patient care. It also made it really amazing to watch the clinic grow and develop in front of our eyes because we really came to care about the people that it was going to serve.
One of the things I enjoyed most about the trip was the ability to follow the clinic's first inpatient. It was a gratifying experience to follow the progression of a serious infection to recovery.
Upon returning from Awarabang, I have realized that our efforts do not have to end with our departure. There is a lot that is needed in the rural village we worked in, and one need is emergency transport, especially given that the villages are remote and far from the clinics and hospitals. We hope to continue our efforts in Awarabang and hope that NICOM students will continue their involvement in contributing to the advancement of healthcare in rural Ghana.
Akwaba!
Akwaba! 2011 is the 50th anniversary of the founding of the Peace Corps. With over 200,000 Americans serving people in communities around the globe, our story offers a celebratory tip of the hat to the Peace Corps.
Struggling to break the bonds of mass misery,
we pledge our best efforts to help them help themselves. If a free society cannot help the many who are poor, it cannot save the few who are rich.
Happy 50th birthday, Peace Corps!
Peace Corps, happy 50th birthday! Yeah!
Happy 50th birthday, Peace Corps.
Happy 50th birthday, Peace Corps.
Happy 50th birthday, Peace Corps.
Happy 50th, Peace Corps.
Happy 50th birthday, Peace Corps.
Happy 50th, Peace Corps.
Happy 50th birthday for the Peace Corps.
Happy 50th anniversary, Peace Corps.
Happy 50th birthday, Peace Corps.
Today we're going to explore the ancient city of Akko. It's a combination of a city and history that goes back 5,000 years and a fortress built during the times of the Crusades.
The history of Akko and the fortress that dominates it are almost timeless. The mythical Greek hero Hercules healed his wounds with herbs found in Akko. Akko was a favorite of Alexander the Great as well. But the city's history is also turbulent. It's no surprise to find its major attraction a cavernous, vaulted fortress. Twice captured by crusaders, then held under siege and sacked by the overwhelming Mamluk forces, Akko was left in ruins. Eventually, the Turks took control of the city, saw it attacked by the armies of Napoleon, and let it fall into British hands. In 1948, Israel gained control of this ancient city.
You'll be able to walk into halls like this, the Knights Hall, and be able to check out some of the architecture from the days of the Crusades.
I'm running through the tunnel because back in the day, if I had heard an alarm and I was out in the quarter, I'd have to escape down into this tunnel, run a couple of hundred feet to emerge within the fortress and be safe from the harm that was approaching from the outside. As you exit the fortress, you're gonna come to this craft shop, and there's some history here, sir. Tell me a little bit about...
He told me about his father's silver trade in Libya, the switch to copper in Israel, and the combining of the two. He seemed like a genuine guy, and that's what I was after. So I checked out the rest of this local market just outside the citadel. I found merchants, artisans, bakers, and even a few aspiring fishermen.
All right, so what do you guys have here? What do they have here?
The marmul.
Marmul.
Mamul, that's the name of the type of fish?
Yeah.
Now, I want to know how they caught all these fish. With a reel?
Spook. Shabok.
How'd you get them? With a net?
With a net.
Ah, you got them with a net, huh? Sneaky, very sneaky. What I love about a town like this are these little shops. In this case, there's a shop here. And this is actually incense, and you can pick it up and smell it, get an idea, and then just buy it, put it in a bag and take it with you. There are all sorts of different spices, and there's this one that's right here. This spice, actually I don't think this is a spice, this is actually a virgin lemon, and it's from Iran. And if you actually took this lemon and you wanted to cook with it, it would give you a faint aroma of lemon, faint, in your actual This is Allah, and here in Akko, which is in the old city, it's an Arabic town, you have something known as baklava.
Yeah.
And you have a lot of it.
Yeah.
Right?
I drooled. I literally slobbered on myself like a Pavlovian dog when Anna introduced me to the popular pistachio and almond baklava. Squares and rolls of the treat tempted me from trays along the walls of her father's bakery. What can I say? I gave in. As you walk the streets and markets of Akko, you're walking through 5,000 years of history. But more than just landmarks, there is an authenticity to this city. Yes, if I had one word to describe Akko, it would be authentic. The colors, the sights, the sounds, the tastes of Akko reflect the history of the city and the lives of the people living there today. A day in Akko can be an engrossing sensory experience as well as a tiring one. It is important to take a minute at the end of the day to relax and just check out the scene. It's historic, sure, beautiful as well, but entirely genuine.
Alan Kelly, a documentary producer and editor, visited the Lower Ninth Ward known as Ground Zero to see it firsthand. He produced two short documentaries for Travel Television to share his experiences.
Only reason I call this lousy animal. But you see, when I heard this Katrina, you know what I remember? September 9, 1965, Hurricane called Bessie. We're all standing on the porch. Mom, six kids, and my grandmother says, now you know we got to feed these babies. Dush, she hit that water. And we was like, look at grandma, you know what I mean? And then my grandpa hit it and my dad hit it. And all of a sudden it disappeared. And everybody got quiet, like, where did they go? And then all of a sudden, here come grandma. Grandma's side stroking with a case of cans. My grandfather right behind a case of cans on his shoulder. And dad the same. And so I never figured nothing was wrong. But then I was in Oregon, headed to California. Because I swore I would never come back here. I've been gone for 25 years. And didn't miss it none. And then when I heard Katrina, and when I walked in there, it was the first time in my life I ever called Louisiana my home. I still today don't believe that I call this place home. But I felt to believe it was my turn to swim for them cans.
Assistance for the people in New Orleans in this local area, particularly in the Night Ward, up in the lower, to keep people's land in their in family's name. And we gutted like 1,700 houses during the gutting process. That was the first phase, from 12 to 1,700. That's a lot of houses. We had a lot of volunteers doing it. Right now we're in the rebuild portion of it. That's where we need the skilled labor at. The volunteers that you see walking around, they come from all over the country to assist us in this. But these are young kids that haven't had a certified skill yet. You know, like a certified electrician, certified plumbers, master plumbers, architects, things of this nature. They're very valuable. We love them, we need them, and I thank them dearly for coming to help us.
That's the house that's on our website, this house right here. All right? This is what we need skilled laborers for. We had the opportunity in March to put this house together in 1 month. But after the first week, we had got to the point where we needed the electrician and the okay the electric. It took a month and a half before we got the electricity okay. And that's what stopped us from getting this house done in March. Now the skilled laborers are gone. That's why we can't get it completed.
It sort of sounds like you need something like Doctors Without Borders, but
yeah.
But
now we also
with electricians and contractors. And
right. We had Veterans for Peace here for a period of time. And they were a tremendous asset. That's the type what we have. All individuals that have time and the knowledge, one at a time, that'll help us out. It's not just homes that build a community. We also need the human aspect addressed. We need, you know, like sociologists, people that are skilled in drug addiction, depression,
psychologists.
The soul of the person. You know, we spend a lot of time, a lot of effort on structures, but we need to work on the people as well.
Me, I couldn't stand to be here 3 days. But now, because of Common Ground, I came here, right? And Common Ground was around. And I'm like, Common Ground, where they'll be here for a blink of an eye and a smile, and then they're on their way. You know, that's the way I felt. But I understood one thing after being around for a minute. Understood Martin Luther King dream. Katrina bring it alive. That all God children stop their lives and cross the nation to help these people get their lives back online. Daniel Williams. I'm from the Lion's Den. Daniel was in the Lion's Den. You know what I mean? And this is the Lion's Den.
They can tell you that it's over. And I better step aside. But nobody but you can decide. I know people gonna talk the way they do sometimes. But don't let them change your mind. Let them change your mind.
Common Ground is still on the ground in the Lower Ninth Ward and has completed work on over 3,000 homes, businesses, schools, and churches with volunteers. Today, in addition, Common Ground has expanded to job training and preservation of the wetlands. For more information, go to commongroundrelief.org.